Saint Peter, the first apostle, the first patriarch of Antioch, and the first pope. Peter was born in the town in Bethsaida, the son of Jonah, along with his brother, Andrew the Apostle. Peter and Andrew grew up in the local area as fishermen. Andrew, who was good friends with John the Baptist, met and introduced Jesus to his brother, who was actually named Simon. It was Jesus who actually gave Simon his name, Peter, which is a Greek word translating to rock, rocks or hard rough surface. He helped Peter catch a few fish, helped Peter's mother-in-law who was ill, witnessed many miracles being performed in public. Jesus proclaimed that upon this very rock I build my church to Peter, and gave him the keys as well. After the Last Supper, Peter denies Jesus three times and cries, and then Jesus died. J.K. He resurrected from the dead and is A-okay. Although Peter had seen Jesus several times after the resurrection, the last time came, where upon a hillside, Jesus, with the power of the Holy Spirit, told Peter and all his apostles to baptize the nations of the world, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now Peter was head of the apostles, so naturally he became the next leader of the church, which was a big responsibility. On top of this, he had to contend with the world's largest growing empire, the Romans, and if that wasn't bad enough, he also had to deal with the Jewish people who still questioned and quarreled with them. Peter wanted to replace Judas, on the account that A, had betrayed Christ, and B, was kind of dead. So they replaced Judas Iscariot with Matthias, now numbering 12 apostles once again. One day, while walking with John the Apostle to the local temple, Peter encounters a man who was unable to walk since he was born. Seeing Peter, he asked for coin as he was unable to provide for himself. Peter instead said, "Silver and gold I have none, but what I have, I give thee, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, arise and walk." And so he arose and walked with both apostles into the temple, praising God himself. Next, the Sadducees took both Peter and John into custody, to which they demanded that they stop preaching about God and Jesus, even going so far as to threaten them. Peter and John remarked in their own testimony in response, speaking of the miracles and of the death and resurrection of Jesus. With all that was said, the Sadducees let Peter and John go, not sure how they were going to punish the two apostles just yet. Peter and John began to move around, mainly in the area of Samaria, also visiting places like Lydda to spread and teach the word of God. Before we continue Peter's story, we have to speak about someone else, someone who was very important as well. Now, at this time of the early church, there was much persecution, but none were more feared than the who came from Tarsus, Cilicia, feared by many people, even the apostles themselves. No man had placed such fear into the hearts of Christians before. God and heaven felt the world shake in fear as he went from town to town, house to house, room to room. No one was spared. Every man, every woman, and every child would be sought. He committed many in Jerusalem to prison. When he could not, he would threaten you, and when that did not work, he would slaughter you, even going as far as to demand the very letters of Damascus to the synagogue to find these people. This man, this legend who did the work of the Jews, was Saul, Saul of Tarsus, persecutor of the Christians. As Saul made his way towards the city of Damascus, he almost forgot his way. That's when it happened. Paul was commanded by God to go to Damascus. However, he was blinded and did not eat or drink anything for several days. When arriving, a certain Saint Ananias, who not only helped Paul, but with the help of God returned Saul's vision to him and baptized him into the faith, whereupon this he helped Paul escape the city as the Jews attempted to kill him several times. From there Paul went on to return to Jerusalem to spread the word of God. Now back to Peter, who's been busy around the area once again. Peter had been operating in the ancient town of Joppa, where Peter gave yet another miracle, bringing the girl, Tabitha, back from the dead. And while he was here, the many times he spoke to people, he realized that God did not hold any partiality to his people. Despite those like Saul or even the Romans with their acts, he treated everyone with equality. Now Peter had been making the Jews very angry with a lot of what he was saying and doing, plus he had begun to criticize several parts of the Jewish faith that really began to make them mad. King Herod had demanded that James the Apostle be killed by the sword, which pleased the Jews, so Herod decided that he would rally their support by imprisoning Peter. Seeing his fate, he decided to spend much time in deep prayer, where one night, God sent an angel to help Peter escape to safety. And Herod? Mad as ever, but could never catch Peter in the end. Now we continue our story with Saul, I mean, Paul. His name is Paul now. Paul, along with many apostles, went to the ancient city of Antioch, where they had a bit of a disagreement. Paul, like Peter, had spread the word of God far and wide across the world at this point, well, the known world at least. And one people was the Gentiles. Within the Council of Jerusalem, an agreement had been made that Gentile Christians did not have to partake or uphold certain or any Jewish common dance. Some disagreed with the council's ruling. Peter refused to share a meal with a fellow Gentile, which Paul publicly opposed Peter, reminding him that despite being a Jew himself, he lived like a Gentile. So how was it that a Gentile should be made to follow his Jewish customs? It was clear hypocrisy. Now, while many agreed with Peter, Paul, by most if not all accounts, was actually correct, and Peter, later believing the words he said had justice, actually changed his mind about Gentile Christians. Also, this isn't viewed as Peter and Paul falling out, much rather a heated debate, unlike most Facebook platforms. Now, we don't have much on Peter's late life, but we do know that Paul and Peter both went to Rome, so we can follow Paul a bit for now. Paul made his way across the Mediterranean Sea, Peter also made his way. Why Rome, you ask? Well, let me tell you why. Rome was not only one of the largest cities in the world, but also the largest empire at that point in time. On top of this, there was a large group of Christians at Rome, so there was a need for leadership. That is why both Peter and Paul went to Rome. Now we leave Paul and return to Peter. Peter knew he was eventually going to die and decided, with the help of Paul, appointed the next person to lead. Around 64 AD, they chose a man by the name of Linus to lead the church, and it was a good thing too. Fire broke out in Rome, and completely tore the city down. Some blame Emperor Nero while others blame the Christians. Nero, wanting to send a message, gave his public support for blaming Christians. Consequently, Peter and Paul, along with many Christians, would be arrested, tried and executed for this. The last thing we know that Peter did was demand that if he were to be crucified, place him upside down, as he was not worthy to bear the fact that he be condemned the same as Christ. For extra measure, the Romans did this request and then set Peter alight. In 64 AD, the first pope had been killed and Rome was about to go on a killing spree. Now we start with Linus, who was not actually known for much. According to the Liber Pontificalis, it says he was born in Volterra, Tuscany, to a father named Herculanus and a mother named Claudia. In the second epistle to Timothy, Linus's name is mentioned, but we are not certain if Claudia, who is named here, is the same Claudia that birthed Linus, or is another person. This is the only biblical mention of the man. Linus grew up around the city of Rome. For whatever reason, he began following the Christian faith, eventually meeting and becoming good friends with Paul the Apostle, who was the one to ordain him as a priest. But he was chosen by Peter to follow as the church's leader, and after the great fire in Rome, Peter and Paul were both publicly executed by order of Emperor Nero, making Linus the de facto leader. Linus has a big responsibility to uphold the leadership of the church, so he ordained 15 other bishops across the city of Rome to help him run things much easier, especially since the Romans were still hunting them for sport. Now we're about to talk some serious Christian doctrine. I'm talking major theology, so don't mind the brain frying while I dig in. Linus supported Paul's stance on the topic of women covering their heads during the Mass or worship as it was known. Before we make any judgments, let me explain why this is so complex. Men and women were not created equally. Men were created by the image of God, while women were created from that very image, Adam and Eve. Men are designed to lead the church while women are supposed to support and uphold those values, not on the basis of sexism, but on the basis that when women do not understand the natural order that God created, the natural order of mankind is to turn to sin and away from God, and when women, who are depicted by the word as vulnerable, they bring down the innocent, children and strong, the men, will follow them down with it towards sin. Paul saw the failure of Adam and Eve and wanted people to follow the hierarchy of the church not based on sexism but based on God's word. That being said, this is still discussed today, and for context, not everything in the Bible is just literal as well. Linus still upheld that tradition of covering women during the worship, and did so for his entire reign. While not much else is presented about his life, we do know that he appointed of the 15 bishops he ordained as his successor a man named Cletus. Now we know that Linus was killed as a martyr by the year 76 to 79 AD. Some even dispute 80 AD. Next in line is Cletus, or Anacletus. He had a few names. Cletus was born in the very city of Rome itself, with a Greek name which translates to one who has been called or one who has been called back. So it fit well with the fact that he was put next in line by his friend Linus. All we really know about Cletus is that he ordained a lot of men into the priesthood and created over 25 different parishes across the city of Rome. A parish is a local community that works within the area or region of a specific church, allowing for Christianity to spread more in the Roman Empire and the grand city itself. After that, we know that Cletus died a martyr in 91 AD. And that's about it for Cletus. Now it's time for the man, the very myth, the legend himself, Clement I. Clement was also born in the city of Rome, around 35 AD. He was briefly mentioned in the Bible, the Epistle to the Philippians. Other than that, no other pope will ever be mentioned again by name in the Bible after that. Clement was ordained by Peter the Apostle and was a part of the church leadership, much like Paul, Linus, and Cletus. However, conflicting sources list Clement as the immediate successor to Peter, while others argue that Linus and Cletus were before Clement. Today he is regarded as the fourth pope. The first epistle of Clement was made by Clement I, but not the second epistle. The first addresses the Christians of the city of Corinth, while the second directs attention towards Christians who converted from paganism. Clement is most known for being seized by the Emperor Trajan, and being sent off to the Greek colony of Chersonesus. There he worked and ministered to the prisoners, whereby praying to God asking for water, he grabbed his pick and dug into the earth, which opened a large body of underground water to the prisoners. The Romans, not liking what Clement had done, decided to wrap a chain and anchor around him, and throw him into the sea, drowning the fourth pope to death. Now Clement is the patron saint of all fishermen, with the symbol of an anchor that often is depicted with him. Now for our last pope, Pope Evaristus. We actually have no idea about Evaristus's early life. All we know about him is that aside from dividing more of Rome into parishes, he also stated,
"In accordance with apostolic tradition, marriage should be celebrated publicly and with the blessing of the priest."
Pope Evaristus was said to have died a martyr, but we really don't know. This is unfortunately a consequence of early church history. We just don't know much. What we do know is that Pope Evaristus was the last pope of the first century. While making this video, our queen passed away at 92 years of age. We hope she is received well into heaven and may King Charles III rule. Long live the king. Long live King Charles.
You know which channels to check out, so please, give us some support.
Remember now, take care, stay safe, and God bless you all. We'll see you in the next video.